and it was from going from Jim Gordon, studio player, kind of an anonymity kind of an approach, to all of a sudden, whammo, being in the public eye and being on stage in front of thousands of people and really, you know, making the jump from anonymity to fame, I guess, you know?
Yeah, it was kind of a strange adjustment. I got real self-conscious about my playing. I'd play real good, or what people, you know, somebody would say, you know, you sounded real good, or that was a great set, or all that. And I'd say, no, it wasn't terrible. And, you know, I'd brood about it and try and say, well, I got to do better next time. I just, it was kind of an adjustment. I was real concerned about doing a good job all the time. You know,
right.
Any mistake.
And so, like, what would you say for, because it seems to me that a lot of times people are more prepared, are less prepared to succeed in life than not, you know? What do you think would be the toughest thing about that, or adjustment-wise, as a human being, spiritually or whatever?
Maybe accepting what you do. And coping with what you have to go through to do it, you know, like there's more than just playing the set that night, you know, you've got the whole day and traveling or whatever, people that you have to interact with, and you have to kind of take a careful look at yourself and not go off the deep end.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's so easy to go overboard in one direction or another, or let yourself go in certain ways that, you know, can be, in the long run, can be really damaging to you.
Right.
So you have to kind of, keep a kind of a center focal point on yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And not let drift too far on either side of that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, where your values are set and what you think is right, you know, or is wrong, and, you know, and how you're going to influence other people that you run into.
Mm-hmm. Was that something you had to, work on yourself, or did that come to you pretty easy, or?
Yeah, I always tried to keep an even keel on what I was doing.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not easy. I've seen so many people that have got a little bit of success and then they just turn around and can't and throw it away, you know. I mean, I know I've done that too.
Mm-hmm.
So what did I do that for? And all of a sudden you're not doing that anymore, you know. And
what do you think that is? What do you think? I mean, why would someone do that?
I'm not really sure, Scott. Maybe it's tension or something.
Mm-hmm. Just not wanting to have all the pressures or...
But I don't think it's something that you say consciously. I think it's something that happens subconsciously.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think that's probably true. You'd mentioned before the spiritual aspect. Is that pretty important to you, or...?
Yeah.
Yeah?
It is important. I try, you know, I believe in God, Jesus, very much, and try and stay above board on all of that, but it's not easy.
Mm-hmm. I know in my own personal life, I think I was about 18 or 19 or something, when I picked up a Bible or something, just because to say, like, what, man, this is really getting nuts, you know? And from, you know, doing a lot of drinking and stuff like that in the 60s and the whole drug scene, just, you know, something never seemed right. It didn't seem like our minds were such great things, you know, and it just seemed that, and Jim Keltner and I talk about this a lot, and creative people, I don't know, it's a tough thing, I think, to get a handle on sometimes, you know.
Mm-hmm. It is. It's definitely something to help you, though. I mean, I find every time I study something from the Bible or or even hear some of these people on television talk about it, you know,
mm-hmm.
Bible study or something like that. It's real uplifting.
Mm-hmm.
I really feel that.
Do you know James Black, drummer? Do you know of him?
No, I don't.
Okay, he's a guy, he said it, he put it beautifully, man. He said, he was talking, he's a great, great player. He's living in New Orleans now, you know, and he's kind of like an Ed Blackwell type of a drummer. Also plays keyboard, great trumpet, you know, everything. And he's about 41 now, and he was saying that, musically, as a drummer, he said that music is melody, rhythm, and harmony. And if you don't have a good balance between those three things in your playing, then you're an incomplete musician. And he was talking about through his life having a lot of discouragement and never really being able to play drums the way he heard them, you know, or the way he wanted to play them. And he said that to get around the discouragement, he prayed, you know, and he said that as human beings, we're physical, we're mental, and we're spiritual, and it's important to keep all those things in balance too, you know.
And, that's great.
Isn't that good?
That's great advice.
Yeah, and I thought that was, pretty good. We ran into a thing with one of the drummers from the Grateful Dead, and we had done an interview. I didn't do it, another guy did it, but there was a paragraph in there where the guy was talking about what was the question? The guy was interviewing him, asked him if he says, do you get high when you play? You know, great question, right? The guy, I won't print this, but it was Mickey Hart was talking about this, and he said that one sentence, he said, no, okay, and then he went on for about a paragraph about how almost like the great benefits of psychedelics and things like this, you know, and I was reading that, and we chose not to print that, you know, and he really got miffed, man. He really got, pissed off that we didn't run that. Yeah.
And he said he didn't get high.
Yeah.
Huh.
You know.
Okay.
Yeah. So,
Well, I don't like to get high when I play.
No, most good players don't, you know.
Uh-huh. It's not worth it. I mean, I have.
Yeah. As a spiritual thing, has that been a part of you since you were younger, or is that something you developed later on?
Well, lately I don't know. I went back and forth. I've always believed in God, but I questioned myself a few years ago because there was a lot of my friends questioning themselves, and I thought, well, yeah, maybe I should ask a few questions again and see where I'm at, and so I bought a Bible and started getting into it again.
Mm-hmm.
A little bit, and found it real helpful. I go to church from time to time and enjoy that very much.
Mm-hmm.
But I'd always tried to be with God.
Mm-hmm.
And I think pretty much I do.
Yeah, once you become aware of that too, you know, it's like it's a strange thing. You know, it's like you can't go backwards from that point. You know,
mm-hmm.
You find that
once you become aware of your religiousness again.
I guess so. Yeah, or your spiritual aspect of your life. You know, if you start asking questions and you start getting answers and you learn more, and it's almost like. You can't really go backwards, and all of a sudden you can't deny that part of a human being or the importance of a spiritual side of a musician or even a corporate exec at IT&T or something like that. I mean, you know.
I don't think I've ever been away from spiritualism in one way or another.
Mm-hmm.
I tough not to have, something to believe in around.
Yeah.
Really?
Man. So that's, definitely important. So the next shot then is there a name for the band yet?
Well, not right now. We're still working on. Well, we've got a name, but I'm not supposed to tell you.
The Jim Gordon Experience.
Jim Gordon Experience. it's a kind of a little bluesish band. Real good songs. And our next step is we've got some tunes on tape, and we've got a manager of company, Alive Enterprises, and we're gonna cut an album and try and go on the road.
Great.
Play for some people.
That'll be good, man.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it very much.
Yeah, you think you guys will hit the East Coast if eventually?
It's a possibility.
Yeah.
I don't see why we can't. We might go to Japan as well. They're thinking about sending us over there.
Yeah.
And I'd love to go to Japan. I've never been there. I understand. I know they're real music. Love American music.
Oh yeah.
I worked on a lot of projects here in town with Japanese producers and artists.
Mm-hmm.
And they're really fun.
Mm-hmm. That's great. You ever thought about writing, like not music writing, but just, articles or anything like that?
No, I never have. Never have. That's something I don't think I ever could do. I'm still trying to play the drum.
Yeah. So, man, well, it's been good. It's good talking to you. God.
Well, I really appreciate it.
Yeah. I'd like to do it with this. If it's okay with you, the same way. What I usually like to do with interviews, what I'll do with the tape is transcribe it, I transcribe the whole thing word for word, and like what I did with Keltner, and then I'd like to send you a copy of the complete transcription, and when you get a moment or something like that, if you could just go over it, if there's anything you want to add or take out or something like that, and so that when it goes to print, I think I was telling you about this, it's so something that you're happy with.
That would be great. I'd love to do that. I sure will.
Okay. Do you have a mail address, Jim?
I do. Yes. It's 6540.
Hang on. Let me write on something I can write on here. 6540.
Havenhurst. That's Havenhurst. Street.
Havenhurst. Got it. Street?
Street.
Mm-hmm.
Number 24.
Number 24.
Van Nuys.
Okay.
California.
Mm-hmm.
91406.
Okay. All right. Well, listen, I think we covered a lot of stuff.
Uh-huh.
How were the questions?
They were great. I know what to say, but I sure appreciate it, Scott.
Oh, man. Well, listen, this has been a guess. Do you have my home phone?
Yes, I do. Okay. That's the one.
It's,
I only have one number on you.
Which one you got?
Hold on.
Okay.
I've got 667-9198.
Okay, that's the home phone. I'll give you the magazine, too. It's the same 201 area code, 778-1700.
Okay.
Okay. So, I'll...